How to Train Your Dragon has become a beloved franchise from DreamWorks Pictures, boasting three feature-length films and a number of spin-off shows. Apart from the story, lovable characters, and stunning animation for its time, the music is another element that makes the franchise special. Criminally, none of the scores for the three feature-length films have won an Academy Award for Best Score, although all three were nominated. Side rant, How to Train Your Dragon came out in 2010, which is the same year as The Social Network, which won Best Score. I find the score to The Social Network incredibly boring. This upset me because it seems like the Academy only picked it because it was different. And then a few months ago, I realized Tron Legacy, which has a techno-inspired score by Daft Punk, also came out in 2010. So if they wanted to pick a score that was different, they could have picked that one, which is actually good. Anyway, back to our regularly scheduled programming. The music in How to Train Your Dragon seems appreciated by fans, and enough people have expressed curiosity that Universal released an edition of the written score in 2020, 10 years after the film's release. This is an incredibly rare occurrence, which is frustrating to film music scholars, especially those like me, who struggle to transcribe all of the musical elements of a piece from listening alone. Composer John Powell boasts an impressive filmography, although there is not much scholarly musical analysis that exists about him or the music in How to Train Your Dragon. John Powell's thematic development, in my opinion, rivals that of John Williams, a composer that gets a lot of attention, which is totally deserved, but we have to branch out at some point. Some scholarly research that does exist is my master's thesis in musicology, which explores the thematic development in the first film and compares Powell's technique to Williams in E.T. I am shamelessly linking my thesis in the description if anyone wants to read more about that and the John Williams connection. Before we go any further, I do want to note that all of the written music examples I will use in this video are my original transcriptions from my thesis. Powell was adamant that no one upload any version of the published score to the internet, so I am not using the full orchestration from the score, even though I have my own copy. If my music examples seem sparse, that is because they are transcriptions. But since the main focus of the video is on single line themes, this isn't too much of an issue. If you are interested in the harmonies and orchestration and such, I encourage you to purchase a copy of the score for yourself. This video pulls a lot from my thesis and will focus on the development of one theme that I call the friendship theme. If you have access to the score, whoever wrote the introduction calls it flying theme motif. I have thoughts about this. Lots of thoughts that I don't have time to go into here. In short, I think calling it flying theme motif oversimplifies how the theme functions in the film, which will hopefully become clear in this analysis. Now, on to talking about the actual music. The friendship theme appears in four different versions throughout the film. I call these versions major and minor, and then the other two are simply combination one and combination two, since they are combined versions of the major and minor versions. The four versions of the theme are shown here. Let's listen to each version in isolation. The friendship theme first appears in the minor version, about 12 minutes or so into the film. After shooting down the Night Fury dragon in the opening battle, our hero Hiccup goes searching for the dragon in the woods. He stumbles upon a large skid mark that appears as if it was made by a large creature. The music here is kind of spooky, employing horror tropes such as musical jump scares, extended string techniques, and harsh dissonances. Hiccup follows the skid mark and approaches the fallen dragon, assuming it is dead. He is understandably scared when the dragon shoves his leg away. The music shifts from those horror tropes discussed earlier to a steady drum pattern that brings an air of determination to the scene, matching Hiccup's initial resolve to kill the dragon. However, after he shouts, "I am a Viking," twice, as if to convince himself, he realizes he cannot kill the trapped creature. This is where we hear the minor version of the friendship theme for the first time. The minor friendship theme employs a downwards leap from E to a perfect fifth interval, which is larger than the perfect fourth leap used in the major version. This is followed by a descending scalar passage that is lengthened with a repetition of each note, illustrating how Hiccup is weighed down by the weight of the decision of whether or not to kill the dragon. Furthermore, the scale arrives on a unison B, far away from the tonic D suggested by the scale, which leaves the listener unsettled. The B natural instead of B flat does suggest a modal D Dorian for the passage rather than D minor, but we don't need to get into that here. I chose to call this version minor because of how it functions independently of the harmonic context and as a direct contrast to the major version, which does sit more comfortably in a major key. Using a scale that lands far away from the tonic D creates an unsettled feeling. Additionally, the orchestrational choice of the violin section, rising to a full forte at a slow tempo, adds to the emotional turmoil felt by Hiccup as he holds the knife above his head, struggling with the question of whether to uphold the values of his village or his own conscience. Orchestration, or deciding what instrument plays what part, is very important in film music. For example, giving a heroic fanfare to a clarinet, as much as it pains me to say as a clarinetist, would not have the same impact as giving it to a trumpet or a horn. One thing that a lot of people don't know is that a team of people normally orchestrates the music for films. This is normally due to time constraints, as the main composer simply does not have enough time to write out his or her own orchestration. Some composers, such as John Williams, write out detailed notes for their orchestrators to execute their vision for the music. Powell talks some about orchestration in interviews, although he has also said that he would be shit at it. So it's unclear how much say he had in the orchestration. All this to say, whoever did orchestrate this scene capitalized on the feelings Powell set up with his unresolved theme to add more emotion to the scene. The friendship theme returns in a similar fashion later in the same scene after Hiccup cuts Toothless's ropes. Here, the friendship theme begins as before, but moves to a downwards half-step motion at the end of the third measure instead of the descending scale heard earlier. This time, it is Toothless's turn to decide whether or not to kill Hiccup. The visuals are focused on the eyes of the characters as Toothless glares down at Hiccup. This is similar to earlier in the scene. The way the cinematography focuses on the fear and apprehension in the character's eyes echoes each character deciding whether or not to kill the other. Likewise, Powell supports this visual choice by using the minor friendship theme in both instances. The orchestration holds an aggressive edge with the use of a galduca. It sounds kind of like bagpipes, and there is a bagpipe drum underneath, but the melody is played by the Scandinavian instrument shown here. The modality, dissonances, and aggressive orchestrational choices in this scene work together to create a frightening musical world that matches the fear of the protagonist. If you watched my Code Geass analysis about Matter Sky, which will be linked here or in the description, I talk a lot about how the music in the show is different from the soundtrack. In How to Train Your Dragon, for the most part, the music on the soundtrack is identical to what is heard in the film. There is one notable exception to this, relating to the friendship theme. In the film, the first time we hear the theme is in the scene I just talked about. However, the theme is heard earlier in the soundtrack, on the track called Down Dragon. Assuming the opening of the track connects to the rest of the track that is in the film, it serves as a sort of foreshadowing to the scene before Hiccup and Toothless meet face to face. In the film's commentary, the director said they removed music from the scene that shows a conversation between Gabber and Stoic to make it seem more serious. However, when the full track is started with the film so that the music that is in the final cut shows up when it is supposed to, the first instance of the friendship theme falls when Stoic tells Gabber Hiccup is different from the others. Since that was a very confusing word vomit, I will recreate that here since it's easier to just experience than explain.
You don't!
Listen, you know what he's like. From the time he could crawl, he's been different. He doesn't listen, he has the attention span of a sparrow. I take him fishing and he goes hunting for trolls.
Trolls exist? They steal your socks. You don't.
Listen, you know what he's like. From the time he could crawl, he's been different. He doesn't listen, he has the attention span of a sparrow. I take him fishing and he goes hunting for trolls.
Trolls exist? They steal your socks.
This placement of the friendship theme means it is introduced in the major version, with the exception of the opening interval, rather than the minor version. This is a much more hopeful way to introduce the theme, which aligns well with the story, since the two enemies will become best friends. So it serves as a sort of foreshadowing to that. After the down dragon scene, what Powell does next with this theme is change the modality and introduce it a little bit at a time. This takes place in a cue called Forbidden Friendship, which begins about 29 minutes into the film. In this scene, Hiccup slips into the cove where he found the trapped dragon earlier. He gives a peace offering of a fish to the creature. The music begins with a loud stinger when the dragon grabs the fish from Hiccup's hand. The music then settles into a series of eighth note ostinato figures at a moderate tempo and bell-like percussion instruments. The repeating figures in these instruments, along with the gentle melodic content in harp and celeste, lend a silvery, dreamy timbre to the scene. The rhythmic drive and ethereal texture suggest the hesitancy and disbelief of the characters that a friendship between a dragon and a human could occur. Powell introduces the major version of the friendship theme over this dreamy texture. Whereas he introduced the minor version in its entirety, the new major version is introduced in fragments, slowly growing into a full iteration of the theme as the scene culminates. The use of fragments at the beginning of the cue, converging into a full but new version of the theme, illustrates musically the friendship beginning to blossom between these two characters. The full major version of the friendship theme opens with a perfect fourth instead of a perfect fifth, like the minor version. In terms of bass movement, this creates a sense of harmonic arrival rather than departure. The following scale descends more freely than the minor version, with the last three notes making their way to the tonic B, unencumbered by repetition. Ending on B, the local tonic for the first half of the cue, adds a sense of completion that sets the listener at ease. In Forbidden Friendship, the friendship theme begins with only the first quarter note of each measure of the full theme, after Toothless graciously invites Hiccup to eat the newly regurgitated fish segment. Paul quickly adds the perfect fourth interval discussed previously to the thematic fragment as Toothless waits patiently for Hiccup to eat his gift. Powell quickly abandons the opening perfect fourth interval to develop the second half of the first two measures of the theme as Toothless tries to imitate Hiccup's post-fish-eating smile. The repeating fragments cut off abruptly when Hiccup reaches out his hand to try to touch the dragon. After Toothless bares his teeth and flies off to relax by himself, An upwards harp glissando leads the cue away from B major into D flat major as the dragon watches a bird fly away. When Hiccup attempts to examine the dragon's broken tail, one hears the first note of the theme, now in D flat major, followed by an almost completed third and fourth measure. This portion of the theme continuously loops as the scene shifts to Hiccup drawing a picture of the dragon in the dirt. The full theme in D-flat then continuously repeats in glockenspiel, harp, and marimba, building confidence through crescendo and repetition. Toothless examines Hiccup's drawing, then attempts his own drawing, and the orchestration shifts from vibraphone to strings when we see Toothless's clumsy drawing of Hiccup. At this point, Powell begins to work his way back to B major with a sequential pattern in the violins that aligns with Hiccup's winding walk through Toothless's drawing. The sequence lands on B major when Hiccup exits the drawing to find himself standing right in front of the dragon. He has now come full circle in proximity to the dragon from the beginning of the scene, which is supported musically by the return to B major. The full and continuously moving orchestration drops to quiet sustained chords in a wordless choir, celeste, vibraphone, and strings, with a B pedal in the bass. The residue of the constantly moving energy from the rest of the scene is present in a snare drum figure on each downbeat. A solo voice moves hesitantly through suspensions, showing there is still uncertainty between the characters. These musical elements capture the nervous tension of the moment as Hiccup decides whether or not to try touching the dragon again. The drums disappear when Hiccup turns away and stretches out his hand towards Toothless's nose. Likewise, the B pedal changes to an F sharp, essentially turning the B major chord upside down in what we call second inversion, as Hiccup holds out his hand. This unstable chord moves to a more stable yet still unresolved F sharp major chord in string harmonics, as Toothless gently lays his nose into Hiccup's hand. The lack of resolution in the sustained chords ends the scene on a half cadence, which is when a piece ends on the dominant or five chord rather than the tonic one chord. The lack of resolution back to one chord suggests that while trust has been gained, there is still much potential for the development of Hiccup and Toothless's friendship. Now that we have examined the introduction of both the minor and major friendship themes in How to Train Your Dragon, there is one other scene I want to highlight that uses this theme. This is the scene where Hiccup is forced to fight a dragon in front of the whole village after placing first in his dragon training class. Instead of killing the dragon, Hiccup shows the villagers how to tame it. However, this angers Stoic, who realizes his son has been tricking him up until this point, and smashes his hammer against the side of the ring. The loud noise spooks the dragon, who attacks Hiccup. Toothless conveniently hears his friend screaming and manages to escape the cove and join the fray in the ring. Although Toothless wrestles the other dragon to save Hiccup, the Viking spectators jump into the ring to capture the Night Fury. Toothless, feeling threatened, tackles Stoic and opens his mouth to smite the Viking leader. Hiccup desperately yells at Toothless to stop. The dragon obeys, and the music, which has been pretty chaotic up to this point, dies down to a single B diminished chord. Toothless lowers his head and gives Hiccup a sheepish look. Then a drum roll leads into the friendship theme, which enters in the violins when a hammer, thrown by a villager, hits Toothless in the face. The theme begins with the descending ascending perfect fourth, followed by the major second of the major version. However, the next group of eighth notes starts on the wrong note for the major version. Based on previous occurrences, the A should descend by minor third to an F sharp. The presence of the F natural is the first thing that is wrong with the theme. The F natural leads downwards not to a perfect fourth or perfect fifth, but to a minor sixth, creating an even greater divide between the notes, which perhaps illustrates the chasm of mistrust that is opening between the friends. The next set of eighth notes extends even farther down to a major sixth. The melody then oscillates between minor seconds before dropping another minor sixth and wandering aimlessly downward until it rests on the F sharp that should have come eight measures sooner. The theme seems unstable, not sure if it wants to be in the major version or the minor version. The harmony is also unstable, switching between inverted D minor and D major triads with G minor chords in between. The cello counter melody, with its contrasting triplet, adds to the scene's emotion and turmoil, while the descending bass line illustrates Toothless's descent into despair. The melody, orchestration, and harmonies all create a heart-wrenching atmosphere, accentuating the pain and betrayal of Toothless as he is captured while his best friend watches helplessly. Powell brilliantly weaves together this version of the theme to illustrate the confusion of Toothless at the seeming betrayal of his friend, who is not able to save him from the rest of the Vikings. In particular, the progression of the theme from the major version to the minor shows a regression in the bond of trust between the friends. In fact, the major version of the theme does not return until the two friends are reunited and fight the giant dragon master. At this point, the theme intertwines with another theme that I call the truth theme, which together relate to flying. But I'll save that for another video. For now, I hope you have enjoyed just a piece of the genius that is John Powell's thematic development in How to Train Your Dragon. Thank you so much for watching, and please do like and subscribe if you appreciate this content.